My name is Susie Brewer, and I am a Refsum patient. I'm in Sydney, Australia. In terms of my story, I am probably textbook case of Refsum. First symptom that would have been noticed was by the pediatrician was that I had my fourth toe on both feet were short. My dad decided that I should join the girl guides, and when we were walking there, that was when we discovered that I couldn't see in the dark. And then at school, there was like a lot of, testing. And then they noticed there was something wrong with my eyes. And then I had to go see an ophthalmologist. And that was when I was diagnosed with retinitis pigmentosa. But I did notice in primary school that my peripheral vision started to get worse. By the time I was in high school, I lost my peripheral vision. When I was about 14, they told me that I had retinitis pigmentosa. All I think I really understood was that I had to wear sunglasses and eat vitamin A. My dad used to make me eat lots of carrot, which I hated. I don't think I fully appreciated it until I was playing squash and I hit another girl in the head very hard with a squash racket, and she did not speak to me again after that. I should also say that doctors weren't particularly supportive, telling my parents that I was probably never going to work and I should learn how to type. In any event, I went to uni and managed. I studied law and ended up becoming a lawyer, which I still am. In my late 20s, I started noticing hearing loss, and I started going to a series of ENTs in my 20s, 30s, and early 40s. So by the time I started seeing all of these ENTs, I told them about my RP and my hearing getting worse and having a sense of smell, and none of them put, all of the dots together. I decided to become a bit fitter and got a personal trainer and started to lose weight. I had a rapid onset of all the neurological symptoms. I was having difficulty walking, having difficulty holding myself up, feeling dizzy, eventually lost complete sensation in my feet. My doctor could not work out what was wrong with me. I ended up seeing my neurologist, and she immediately worked out what it probably was. Well, perhaps the next day I had a whole day of tests in hospital. I was there for a few weeks and it was pretty awful and isolated. They'd never seen anyone with such high phytonic acid levels before. I went into rehab hospital and got released because I wasn't improving. It took me a much longer to start to walk again. It took me about 18 months. I had a very intensive plasmapheresis. For me, I guess one of the hardest parts is eating out because, well, the other day I was at my local cafe and I asked them, I normally have something else, but I asked them whether their schnitzel was marinated in milk, and then they said yes. But I also found out that their grilled chicken, which I've had before, is also marinated in milk. You've always got to kind of think about, oh, how was this made? Would it have something in it that might increase my phytonic acid levels? I definitely identify as a person with a disability, and it's pretty obvious since I use a walking stick. I think it's important to identify as someone with a disability because it's only when you're seen that people become more aware of disability, and that disability is a part of life, and people need to think about being more inclusive. I think health practitioners need to be more patient-centric. They should think out of the box, be curious, and kind of think, well, it's a bit odd that this person has all this sensory loss. Maybe it's not a coincidence. Maybe there is a genetic condition. And in retrospect, that shouldn't be that hard. I guess the only thing I would say, that when I got diagnosed, it was quite lonely, and it was great to find the Yahoo group that Susan and Liz set up. And now that we have Dare, I think is such an important organization, not just in terms of helping provide a cure for the future, but also to help patients improve our lives in terms of better information about diet, better information about clinical care. but really importantly to connect patients, because when you've got an ultra rare disease, that is an incredibly lonely thing